Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. And this week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year. RKO, 1945. This is a House of Noir edition. Johnny Angel and Cornered. After that, stay tuned for a Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto discussion of the 1982 documentary on the writer James Baldwin and his reflections on the civil rights era. I heard it through the grapevine. After that, we have one final segment for you. We haven't had this in a little while. Listener letters. You won't want to miss that. As always, let's start with a look at the roster of stars at RKO in 1945. This is taken from Joel W. Findler's The Hollywood Story. He's got a pink and gray chart where he gives us his snapshot of all of the people that had meaningful positions in front of the camera. At this time, he gives them 1, 2, or 3 star ratings, nearest we can figure. This is Mr. Findler's impression of how valuable each person might have been to the studio during the length of their contract. Johnny Weissmuller, 1 star. Pat O'Brien, 2 stars. John Wayne, 2 stars. Barbara Hale, 1 star. Jane Greer, 2 stars. Dick Powell, 3 stars. Loretta Young, 3 stars. George Raft, 2 stars. Lorraine Day, 2 stars. Tim Holt, 1 star. Ingrid Bergman, 3 stars. A brief tenure at RKO. And Maureen O'Hara, 1 star.
Not a lot of big star stars.
No, but some pretty interesting ones.
What is Dick Powell doing at RKO? Just noirs?
Yeah, this is part of his mid-career reinvention of himself at Warner Brothers for the entirety of the 1930s. He had been a song and dance man for the most part, light comedian. When they jettisoned him, he was in the wilderness for a little while. He made some interesting movies while looking for a new studio home. But 1944 with Murder, My Sweet is always taken as this major turning point in Dick Powell's career under the direction of Edward Dmytryk. And here we have another collaboration with Dmytryk in Cornered.
Claire Trevor, is she under contract at RKO? Because you'd think she'd rate at least, well, you know, 2 stars would probably be sufficient.
I don't know. She's not on the chart. But as we've seen, that doesn't always mean anything. Don Ameche is missing entirely from Fox, and he was in all of their movies. And John Payne isn't on their chart either, so...
So she's in Murder, My Sweet, which is RKO, and...
She's in a lot of RKO films, no doubt.
Born but... to Kill is also RKO, so yes, I think she's a 2-star star.
Yeah, but she's not on this chart for whatever reason, and I don't know. She may have had some kind of freelance contract and just kept happening to wind up in RKO movies. Or maybe Joel W. Findler dropped the ball again. Let's launch into Johnny Angel, the earlier of the two films. And for that, the RKO story by Richard B. Jewell and Vernon Harbin, one of the more insightful of these coffee table books that we have. Johnny Angel was the year's major surprise package. Production chief Charles Kerner had no great enthusiasm for it, calling the picture quote-unquote routine, and something that quote-unquote won't set the world on fire. Consumers, however, did a war dance to plunk their admission fees down at the box office, and the mystery thriller eventually earned profits of $1,192,000.
That image is at once offensive and incomprehensible.
Yeah, take it up with Vernon and Richard. Some of Kerner's misgivings were undoubtedly based on the tangled plot strands and clumsy flashbacks that infected Steve Fisher's screenplay, adapted by Frank Gruber from Charles Gordon Booth's Mr. Angel Comes Aboard, but these deficiencies were ameliorated by the moody and suspenseful direction of Edwin L. Marin, the atmospheric photography of Harry J. Wilde, and the forceful performances of Claire Trevor, Signe Hasso, and George Raft as the titular hero. Sea Captain Raft sets out to track down unknown mutineers who killed his father and hijacked gold bullion from his father's vessel. He is aided by a French refugee, played by Hasso, who was on board the ill-fated ship and witnessed witnessed the murderous events. Architect William L. Pereira, winner of an Oscar for his special effects work on C.B. DeMille's Reap the Wild Wind, made an auspicious debut as producer. Jack J. Gross was the executive producer, and Lowell Gilmore, Hoagy Carmichael, Marvin Miller, Margaret Witcherly, J. Farrell MacDonald, and Mac Gray were also cast. Hoagy Carmichael and Paul Webster wrote Memphis in June, a song used in the picture. Note, Signe Hasso was borrowed from MGM. She had spent a year under contract to RKO during the Schaefer period, but had never been used in a picture. So, a lot of enthusiasm there for Johnny Angel.
I don't know why the flashbacks are clumsy, though. There's no attempt to explain that.
No, they just make statements.
When you're marking a paper and you have so many papers you have to mark, you know that you're supposed to say something negative as well as positive or positive as well as negative, and you just pick anything.
You just underline something and say on the margin, awkward.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I love this movie. Love it.
It's very good.
I've always loved it. This is one of those that I saw in the 80s and taped off TV. Had no expectations whatsoever as to its quality, but was blown away by it, and I rewatched it quite a bit as a kid. It's directed by Edwin L. Marin, who also directed Nocturne with Raft. I think of him as the Raft whisperer, because he gets amazing performances out of George Raft. I went on record when we did Nocturne. That's one of my favorite movies, period. This one I don't think is quite as great as that, but pretty awesome.
It's good. George Raft is still George Raft. He's still limited, but he can carry a movie anyway.
I don't see the limitations. He's really one of the best at this kind of performance.
What is this kind of performance?
Quiet, but driven. I don't think that he sleepwalks through movies or is wooden or any of the other things that people usually throw at him.
He's not wooden. He's just emotionally limited.
He's not exuberant. There's a lot going on his face when the camera gets in close.
Limited in his dramatic technique. Like, he seems to only be able to play one thing at a time, so that when he is seducing Claire Trevor, by the plot and by the character, you know that this is bullshit, but his acting is so flat that he might as well be actually doing it. Like, there's nothing to give away that this is reluctant.
Interesting. I'm not sure if I see it that way. A valid quibble, possibly. We've got a pretty decent sense of the plot from that review, or that blurb.
A nautical noir, in part, which is unexpected, although lots of French noirs might have a seaport, like Port of Shadows.
Quai des Brumes. The Warner Brothers film, The Sea Wolf, is definitely a full-on seagoing noir. This one isn't that, because most of it really happens in New Orleans. But yeah, it starts out with incredible scenes at sea.
Of course, we just saw Hans Le Marin. There was a line in this movie when the proprietor of that hotel says, "You sailors, when you see a girl once, you always want her again, and always the same girl."
Yeah, that obsessive tendency that we saw in that film.
But it's not true of George Raft. That's not why he wants to see this girl.
No.
So we definitely see quite an arc in their relationship, with him being very brutal and frightening initially. He needs Hoagy Carmichael's character to calm him down. Serves as this mediator between him and Signe Hasso. What's her character's name? Paulette. There's all these ridiculous, pulpy, religious references in the character names, right? Angel and Celestial.
Hoagy Carmichael had a real moment, like in 1945-46. He's in a lot of good movies.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
This one, To Have and Have Not, Best Years of Our Lives.
He has, of course, a very distinctive presence.
He does, and I think this is one of the more distinctive uses of him. He's a cab driver slash guardian angel. Only seems to want to drive people around that he can help.
Yeah.
If it's just a normal cab seeker, he pretends that he doesn't know where the driver is.
The cinematography, of course, by Harry J. Wilde is extraordinary.
Yeah, it's so many wonderful little details of the ship, the port, just life on the docks.
That light on the docks.
Indeed.
The light and the shadow.
And the score is doing incredible work here, too.
Yeah, it's very rich and orchestral at the beginning.
There's almost no speaking. Well, Raft's ship comes upon this ghost ship. Everyone's gone. Not even any dead people on it. It's just empty. It's really the score and the visuals, close-ups on Raft. He communicates agony as he walks around this ship, knowing that he's never going to see his father again.
Yeah, I believe all of his emotions about his father, yes. Yeah,
it's just Claire Trevor.
If he had been sincerely making up to her, for the most part, I couldn't tell the difference between that and what he was doing.
I didn't feel that way at all. But maybe I was giving too much credit.
I'm not seeing the layers. in the Raff performance. The layers are not there, but he's certainly doing intensity at the beginning of the picture, and whenever he has to deal with Gusty, definitely seeing the intensity there.
That guy, Marvin Miller, I never remember the actor's name, but he's very distinctive. He kind of looks like Babe Ruth, but if he was like a complete
slob. These two films are a good reminder that although fat women have a hard time in classical Hollywood comedy being the butt of one-note jokes, coming on screen just for the fat joke, fat men have a really hard time in film noir.
They do, unless they're Sidney Greenstreet. He's having a grand old time, usually.
No, but there's a lot of commentary on size.
Well, that's true. But Marvin Miller's having a terrible experience in this movie. Desperately in love with his trophy wife, Claire Trevor.
Now, this is another instance when we did Leave Her to Heaven, we were talking about that this was an unusual noir because the femme fatale isn't an emotionless psychopath. Instead, she is emotionally fixated on a man. Then you brought up Martha Ivers, Strange Love of Martha Ivers, as another example of that. And here we've got something very much... Claire Trevor's character turns out to be very interesting because she's so violent, psychopathic for most of the movie. And then at the end, she actually gets a kind of redemption. She turns out to have feeling. Of course, she has to try to kill the man before she can feel anything for him.
But... she just decides, that's it. This guy's getting in my way too much. She gets out a knife and goes to the bedroom and stabs him multiple times.
Speaking of fat man getting a hard time in this movie, we're kind of led to believe by what happens before that is that what she can't stand is to have sex with him again. She signed up for this deal, but she can't deal with it.
This is an echo of Murder, My Sweet, because she plays a similar kind of character in a way in that film. Certainly they would have been building on that for her image, which leads me to believe, as you say, she probably had a contract at RKO because they were paying attention to such continuities. But in that film, she had been a singer, married ridiculously frail, thin old man. But she wants out of that relationship as well. She's not nearly as focused on Philip Marlowe as a love object in that movie. The relationship between psychotic lover slash femme fatale and the beloved George Raft in this movie has a lot in common with They Drive By Night, where Ida Lupino just goes mental and destroys whole companies and her life chasing after George Raft.
Well, Claire Trevor doesn't go mental in the same way.
No.
She just tries to murder her husband.
Yeah, well, I mean, Ida Lupino does murder her husband. Doesn't stab him to death. She gives him the gas.
Nothing about doors here.
No, we don't get to that stage with Claire Trevor.
We do get some remorse, though. But let's back up, try to build toward that final scene, because we just missed the entire middle of the movie. So the middle of the movie involves George Raff getting to know Sinya Hasso's character.
He's single-mindedly determined to get to the bottom of this incident. His father disappeared. He's sure he was murdered, but there's no proof of that, really.
And of course, before we even get to his pursuit of this woman, we are introduced. This always takes me by surprise about this movie, because we go from this nautical mystery shot like a film noir to this gothic melodrama, this Freudian gothic melodrama taking place behind the scenes in the business offices of this company.
Gustafson and his childhood nurse, his executive assistant, but really it seems like she's running the company. Everyone keeps throwing that at Gustafson as another example of why he's not a real man.
Now, this triangle here is very economically drawn. It's actually a quadrangle once George Raff shows up. It's very economically drawn. We have to understand it in all its complexity right away because we're not going to get the payoff of the film without it, which is that this nurse has emasculated this boy by coddling him his whole life.
Yeah, it's sort of a Philip Wiley argument about the problem with American manhood.
He's traded her sexless domineering presence in his life for the sexy domineering presence of Claire Trevor. The nurse, of course, disapproves of this because not only has she been replaced, but Claire Trevor is not going to be solicitous of his feelings.
No. She does whatever the fuck she wants.
George Raft completes the quadrangle by being the object of Claire Trevor's obsession. They had some kind of relationship before she married Gusty. More feelings on her side.
I think that's safe to say, yes. When Raft goes back to the boat, police are starting their investigation, but not really. They don't seem to be doing anything. He asks permission to do some investigating of his own, and they give him the okay. After scouring the boat, finds nothing until near the very end, he discovers a shoe, a woman's shoe. This tips him off that an atypical passenger was aboard this merchant marine ship, and he does notice someone has made their escape.
Is there any particular reason why he has to be so aggressive with this woman, other than we're in film noir, so this is misogyny, which the movie is going to undermine, but...
It's very grounded in the plot, right? We know she's French. She's never been to North America before, we can presume, because there've been 6 years of war where you couldn't cross the Atlantic at all in any event. She's in New Orleans, and he reasons that she would have sought some kind of hiding spot in the French Quarter, which is mostly bordellos. In this movie, anyway.
So he thinks she's a whore and that's his excuse?
No, he doesn't. I mean, that's what makes their early scenes so charged and disturbing, right? He's trying to prove to himself and get her to prove that she's not a prostitute. She won't react to the gross way he's behaving the way most women in these establishments would react, which is just,
yes.
Oh, this is par for the course.
I'm just saying, why does he assume that this woman is up to no good? Is my question.
Well, because she's the only surviving passenger on a ship where everyone seems to be dead, and she hasn't come forward. So he barges in there. His only clue is that this is someone who got there that night. She is going to be off her game. She's not going to be able to blend into the environment if he puts pressure on her, and he proceeds to do exactly that.
Yeah, but the pressure he's putting on her isn't only to expose her, but also just gratuitous cruelty because of this suspicion that she's under.
I mean, they work hand in hand. He's angry at the universe for his father's disappearance / death.
Yeah, he just seems to more or less arbitrarily project all of that onto this woman in a way that, because of the genre, seems misogynistic. So I thought that was interesting because the movie then proceeds to undermine that.
Yeah, exactly. And Raft has to carry that character arc and does a great job of it, I think. Because, yeah, he's really vicious with her, and those scenes are hard to watch.
Yeah, especially since this girl is obviously coded as a good girl to us, very disturbed by this treatment of him, and is obviously hiding something for probably a good reason.
He's just modeling the kind of behavior that maybe he doesn't typically display, but most men in that establishment, this is how they behave with all of the women they meet there. No woman deserves this treatment, right? But, yeah, some of them, I guess because they've been through it so much, they would have more defenses against his behavior, and she has none.
Well, he's also shoving her around,
yeah,
when he follows her upstairs to the room. When he asks the bartender or proprietor, maybe both, if there's been any new girls, well, this man is acting to protect the girls from him.
They're not going to divulge anything about anyone in a place like that. If you're asking if there's a new girl there, it could only be because someone who used to be somewhere else is being sought, and it's conceivable that they're hiding in this place.
He also sends the bouncer up to him when he's getting rough, and nobody seems surprised that George Raft is doing any of this, so I'm not sure if this isn't conceivable behavior for him normally.
Possible, but I think it's just, yeah, there's a lot of fights in a place like this. George Raft happens to come out on top in this one, although he's not Superman. He gets knocked out later in the movie.
He overpowers this guy pretty easily.
And yeah, he just keeps breathing down Signahasso's neck.
From the beginning of the movie, we're supposed to feel that he's wrong. I think that is how the movie is directing the viewer.
Yeah, I agree.
And that's why Hoagy Carmichael has to intervene.
Celestial intervention. Now, there's this whole plot line with the gangster, Sam Jewell, who was pretty good, too. I don't know that actor, Lowell Gilmore. He's got some kind of involvement with Claire Trevor.
She worked at his nightclub too, didn't she? As well as the dive?
More than that, they're hanging out together now. Maybe he's a romantic partner for her. Maybe he's a business partner for her. It's not entirely clear at first. And the movie does leave some things unanswered in terms of all the machinations that went on. There's a lot of teasing of the idea that Raft's sainted dad, J. Farrell McDonald, is not nearly the paragon that he's cracked up to be.
Well, yeah, and that's another reason George Raft is freaking out, because he's worried that against everything he believes, could turn out to be the case.
Yeah, he's really terrified that Signahasso is going to reveal something unthinkable to him.
Yeah, but he still wants her to talk.
He does.
She approaches this nightclub. She gets shot at, and that's when Hoagy Carmichael intervenes with her, sequesters her away to this picturesque, some kind of hotel.
Yeah, on the bayou.
It's clear true when he beckons to her that he's trying to help her, but then when he brings George Raff to her, I'm still trepidatious after everything that's happened.
He ultimately knows best, but we don't know that at the time. It seems like he's taking a chance here with Sinyahaso's life or well-being, but I guess he knows George Raff pretty well and understands that he's going to come around.
Just on sight. He knows these two crazy kids will figure things out in the end. And there's a stunning shot of her sitting in the sunlight on the patio.
Listening to the music. Yeah.
Spanish moss,
I think. And the sort of bayou mist.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
It's a really stunning film.
And then he does calm down, and now that she's completely at his mercy, and they actually talk.
This is a World War II story, ultimately. Not as much as Cornered is, which we'll be talking about later, but this one, it's all bound up with the Free French. The only reason she's here is because her father had been with the Free French. He had been entrusted with this gold that was going to fund the anti-fascist operations in North Africa, or I guess even in France. Her father is killed and the gold disappeared. And her quest from that point on has been to clear her father's name. She becomes intrepid, globe-trotting gold hound, and that's how she insinuates herself onto the boat. She does know J. Farrell MacDonald, Raff's dad, from childhood. He's well disposed to her and he takes her on board, but she can see that he's nervous. This is just not a normal trip. As it's all being recounted by her to Raft, again, we're terrified Raft is going to find out Dad has gone over to the bad side. He's actually working with Nazis or the mob. Final analysis, it turns out that he's just kind of a dupe. He goes along with shipping line owner's plan to transport this gold and he doesn't ask questions about it. Presumably Raft would have asked questions.
He sounds like a bit of a wuss, Captain Angel.
I mean, he's a lovable old guy, J. Farrell MacDonald. Donald usually is, except in It's a Wonderful Life where he's yelling at Jimmy Stewart about the trees. But yeah, here he just looks lost on this journey in the flashback. I don't find it a clumsy flashback.
Just a flashback. It's inserted at a perfectly respectable point in the film. What else was supposed to happen? Was she supposed to sit down and tell this all as exposition?
No, I think it really works. I'm on tenterhooks, worried that all of a sudden Daddy Angel has an evil sneer on his face and he's a villain. Now, that's not what happens. It's much sadder and more tragic than that. But we don't know which way it's going to go. You need it to unfold visually for you to get caught up in it. So, I mean, this is just demented plot to get this gold and not share it with anyone. Several layers of conspirators involved here. There's James Flavin, and I think they call him Flavin. But he's the first mate on the ship. He's taking orders from Captain Angel, and then he starts killing people. But he's not the mastermind. He gets killed on the little boat. They kill everybody. And by the end, there's just one person left. One mystery person. Who is it? I remember when I watched this the first time, I thought it was Claire Trevor. Doesn't turn out to be that. It could have been, right? There's not even any proof that it's a man or a woman. There's even a kind of hint of a parallelism there because Sinyahaso observes Captain Angel talking to someone in a room. The captain says, you know, just forget you saw that. That person too is a stowaway of sorts. Like, oh, it's not this time because I've seen this movie before. But when I first saw it, I was like, is this going to turn out to be Claire Trevor killing everybody? But no, she just has that one knife attack.
Now that George Raft has heard this story, he has to find out about the gold. What is it that tips him off that Claire Trevor's involved again? Oh, because he thinks Sam Jewell's involved.
Sam's brother was part of this conspiracy, but he got cut out of the conspiracy and shot to death on the little boat, the Dolphin. All of these different people were involved in it. And nobody knows exactly what happened, except that a lot of people who weren't supposed to die in this venture are dead. And does anyone really suspect that it's actually Gusty that did all of this? That's his great triumph at the end. He's almost unkillable by knife.
Lila and Gusty, were they not in this together?
Well, they were. Yeah, did she know he was going to shoot everyone? I guess she must have known, because she set it up with the jewels, right?
It's a very twisty plot.
Yeah, it is.
But anyway, at this point, yeah, I guess she's betrayed Jewel.
And Gusty now, because she wants to go off with Raff.
But right, she's betrayed Jewel, and she and Gusty are supposed to take all the money themselves from Jewel, but then she decides to go with Raff when he starts digging around using her to find out what's going on, and she thinks he's interested in her again. And it doesn't take her much to decide that she would rather betray Gusty as well and go off with Raff. She doesn't obviously know anything about Paulette.
I mean, this is just another another one of these movies with Raft, because he is so subterranean, it really works to have these women chasing after him and demanding proof of his affections that he doesn't give them. He leaves them wanting a lot more, but it seems to be catnip for them.
Well, he's being nice, finally, at least to Paulette, but he's not being much more. The only reason we know he's interested in her and not in Claire Trevor is because of their types in the movie. We know she's actually out of her mind because of the amount of time she refers to herself in the third person like Jeff T.
It's an occupational hazard of
noir villain.
Yeah, the criminal mastermind, the would-be criminal mastermind.
Well, she's doing better than Jeffy. And yeah, I mean, we've already spoken about this part, but there's like this whole great sequence where George Raft is making up to her at their home when they think that Gusty has left. Then Gusty comes in and he makes a scene and she pretends that George Raft is coming on to her. And Gusty, after he's gone, asks her why she's letting him on. And even though that is what she's been doing, she rolls her eyes.
Yeah.
Oh God, I got to go through this again.
This is the last time.
And I just love the psychological layers of afterwards when they've made up and he's sucked up to her, because he's sucking up to her, but he's also has the power to demand that she have sex with him, and he's telling himself that she wants to, but he also knows that she doesn't. This is how they make it believable that this could make her snap and kill him, right? There is a sense in which she's a sympathetic victim as well as a total psychopath.
Well, Claire Trevor is possibly the greatest at this kind of character, and Hollywood used her in really interesting ways in the 1940s.
And it's just such a great moment between these actors when Marvin Miller is calling her upstairs. He's like, "And you're coming up, aren't you?" "Yeah." "Soon, right?" "Right away." You know, like,
yeah.
Putting those screws in. And then he's going to put the screw in.
She slides the knife into her sleeve.
The knife in. And he, like, drives all the way out to this destination while he's bleeding to death.
A horror film, right? I mean, and it's shot that way. You know what it reminded me of? Wild Oranges, King Vidor.
The New York Times said of the novel, it was a tale of adventure, mystery, treachery, and murder that reaches a happy ending. Ending amid a welter of gore.
Right, well, yeah, we did see some of that on the screen.
And then Gusty has his big dying villain monologue where he explains how it was all him. It's just such a fantastic ending. And then when he starts talking about how much he loves Claire Trevor and how she betrayed him, she actually feels sorry for this man that she's killed who's dying in front of her eyes and starts crying. And then the nurse shows up. She puts him down like old Yeller.
He's out of control. And then she wants to turn to kill Claire Trevor.
Which makes total sense. She should be allowed to do it. The movie is being quite sentimental that she just doesn't get to just kill Claire Trevor too.
Probably won't go to jail for shooting Gusty, but she would for shooting Claire Trevor.
But the idea is that this nurse, and we saw that at the beginning when she tries to use her ruler on George Raft, this nurse has fucked him up, not just by coddling him, but also by disciplining him. But she's emasculated him from both sides, right? And we see her in her final act of judgment and discipline on this love of her life, this boy.
So sad. I mean, that toy ship with the little Christmas tag on it from when he was 6.
And he has to bat it away because George Raft has shoved it in his face as a symbol of his emasculation. And then you see the nurse takes it away and then looks at the note that she wrote for him. She's immediately gone into a fond fantasy land of this childhood relationship. There's just so much going on in this crazy movie.
Of course, we should mention the nurse is played by Margaret Wycherly, who is most famous in cineast circles as Ma in White Heat, Top of the World Ma. That's her.
Different kind of emasculation in that movie. But that's much later, isn't it, White Heat?
49.
Belongs to this moment of film noir mumism, American hysteria over over-mothering.
Well, highly recommended that you seek out and watch and enjoy Johnny Angel and all collaborations between George Raft and Edwin L. Marin. They made like 5 movies together. They're all great, with Nocturne being the absolute pinnacle. Back to the RKO story for Cornered. Producer Adrian Scott director Edward Dmytryk and star Dick Powell followed Murder My Sweet with Cornered, a seething manhunt drama about a demobilized Canadian airman who vows to track down the Nazi collaborators who murdered his French wife. Close-cropped and saturnine Mr. Powell follows a trail from France to Switzerland, then to the hothouse atmosphere of Buenos Aires, where a colony of corrupt Europeans are living in splendor. There, after being wined, dined, seduced, beaten, and nearly killed, Powell finds the malefactors and exacts his revenge. One could quibble with certain narrative confusions in John Paxton's screenplay, story and adaptation by John Wexley, and a few dull spots that firmer editing would have cured. But this was, nonetheless, an edge-of-the-seat thriller whose violent climax left viewers gasping for breath. Also in the cast, Walter Slezak, Micheline Cherel, Nina Vale, Maurice Karnofsky, Edgar Barrier, Stephen Gerais, Jack LaRue, Gregory Gay, and Luther Adler, who doesn't get his credit until after the end of the movie.
Definitely the approach they're using there is the harried teaching assistant marker. Really, really pretty great stuff, but...
Firmer editing.
Firmer editing, as if I know what I'm talking about, because I know all about firm editing and have done a lot of it myself. Firmer editing! What? Anyhow, I don't think the plot is confused, but there's a lot of plot, and fucked if I could follow it all on a first viewing. I did read the extensive plot summary in Wikipedia, which pretty much confirmed what I thought had happened, but it's, you do spend a lot of the movie going, am I really following this?
Well, that's fine. That's the position Dick Powell is in, too.
So Dmytryk, Paxton, and Scott worked together on several projects at RKO.
Yes.
Including Murder My Sweet, as mentioned, and Crossfire. Then Dmytryk and Scott ended up being blacklisted.
Part of the Hollywood 10, so they went to jail in addition to losing their careers, at least for a while.
But Paxton did not. Seems to be a great mystery of the time, how he avoided it.
Yeah, did he actually write through the 50s with no problems?
Yeah, seems so. I mean, of course, I don't know if he was actually a member of the Communist Party as the other two were, but you'd think he would at least been graylisted, but no. Again, we get a blacklister, left liberal, anti-fascist film coming right at the end of the war.
Yeah, and certainly a lot of the cast members got into trouble with HUAC as well. Karnofsky, Luther Adler, I think, had some problems with them too.
And so how do we see this left liberal vision playing out here? Well, there's certainly a lot of open criticism of America.
Oh man, this movie is intense.
It's really intense. I mean, starting with, if you think Raff was brutal at the beginning of Johnny Angel, and I forgot to mention, because I noted it at the time, that tiny little Paulette is holding her own against the big villains in their fist fight toward the end of the movie, right? She's holding this big guy off until George Raff can come around and knock him out.
Mm.
That's nothing compared to Dick Powell in this movie. This man is killing Nazis with his bare hands.
It's clear he's got to kill someone. And yeah, he just pummels this man until he is jello.
Yeah, outside of the more brutal eras of comic books, you don't see a lot of that.
No.
You don't see a lot of that in Hollywood cinema.
He goes into like a fugue state.
Well, I mean, we know from the beginning it's been set up that this is his PTSD.
Yeah, definitely.
From the war, but he's also just very, very angry at Nazis from the war, who killed his wife.
They killed his wife, who was a member of the French Resistance. He is Canadian. Mm-hmm. He's not American, right? Which is important, I think. But there's a lot of talk about how fucked up and useless America is in the post-World War II world, or how uselessly it's behaving. He's from Montreal, and his name is Gerard. Lawrence Gerard.
He doesn't seem particularly French.
I guess somewhere down the line, he drifted into the Anglo side of Montreal. Yeah, he's got no interest in being repatriated. He gets home and immediately demands a passport so he can go back to France and deal with his dead wife's estate. The bureaucrat tells him, well, it's going to be a month or two before we can even look at that. And he just says, well, fuck you. I'm going anyway. We just see him rowing ashore in France later without a passport. He's not going to be deterred.
Now, what can you say about Dick Powell's performance in this movie? I would call it something like impervious. He's just his own center of gravity, and nothing but his PTSD flashbacks can throw him off.
Also, obviously, part of this global tough guy phase that he entered in the 40s, but it's very different from Philip Marlowe in Murder, My Sweet, where he's kind of self-deprecating and romantic in many ways.
No, there's nothing like that here. All the romance happened before the movie starts.
Yeah, this is a great performance by Dick Powell, and a really unexpected one. Audiences must have been even more baffled by this. Like, where did this come from?
Yeah, it's very lacking in vanity. The character does have the audience's sympathy.
Well, he does, but he's really behaving badly. He's crazy. He's very cavalier about murder, and we see that. I mean, the set piece there is he gets this note saying, go kill this guy in his hotel he's packing. It turns out this guy's on his side, and he doesn't care. He's not going to interrogate it at all. He's like, okay, here's a man I can kill. I'm going to do it. He's only prevented from committing an inexcusable murder by these Nazi hunters led by Morris Karnofsky.
But he doesn't care. He's not thrown off for long. I think his inordinate rage is supposed to represent these left liberals' anger at the United States.
Okay, I mean, we have to get big picture with this movie. We can drill down and talk about scenes, but so much of what it's all about comes out in his confrontations with Karnofsky, the lawyer, and the final scene.
Okay, right? Talk.
What this movie is saying is, okay, you fought the Nazis and defeated them, but for the wrong reasons completely. You just went out and fought fascism because they attacked you and they hurt some people that you cared about, but there was no ideological component and there's no understanding of what fascism is.
So you think we are actually, I don't know. Yes, the idea of the movie is that you're supposed to be siding, and we've seen this before in treatments of fascism by leftists in this era. Yeah, the idea is that you're supposed to be siding with the organized resistance, the organized anti-fascist, but the whole movie is thrown to Dick Powell.
You're supposed to be in Dick Powell's shoes because you're a basic American watching this movie for the most part, right? That's where it was distributed and seen.
And he does get to beat the Nazi to death. That is the climax of the movie.
Right, but for the wrong reasons, not for ideological reasons, which the movie wants you to be thinking, okay, it's not just about finding each individual Nazi and killing them. It's about understanding what the ideological stakes are here and what it would take to have a good world. And
that's not going to make a movie, and that's not going to make anybody excited about getting angry about Nazis, the fascist imperialist tendencies of the United States.
But that's what this movie is, if you're saying that that's not...
So you think the movie dramatically convinces you by the end of it that really we should all be getting organized together. Like, that's the emotional heft of the movie, thrust of the movie?
No, but we should be hating fascism, not just because they happen to attack you, but because it's a problem for the world.
Sure, that noise is made in the movie, but that's just not the dramatic arc of it at all.
Well, I think it is. I think it is, because it's showing how impotent his rage is by itself.
It's not impotent!
It is. He wouldn't have gotten anywhere without Karnofsky and his gang. He keeps getting arrested by the police. They keep getting him
out. It's true. Like I said, the movie is making noises in the direction of what you say, but I think dramatically is totally committed to this character, and I don't think any emotion at all ever attaches to these other anti-fascists.
No, but Dick Powell himself, by the end, he realizes, you know, this has been a completely nihilistic rage he's been consumed by.
Sure, and he realizes that after he accomplishes his goal, which is the movie's money shot.
He beats this man to death with his fists, and he keeps saying, okay, wake him up. Get him to talk. Now, the movie kind of cops out there too, because they find the documentation they need to bring down a lot of the other fascists in Buenos Aires, but it seems like it's going to end with, you know, the whole quest going off the cliff with this dead end of Jarnac lying on the ground, beaten to death, no way to defuse the remaining fascist bombs that are planted all over the world and all over the city. At that point, Dick Powell, at other points too, when he nearly kills the guy that had been posing as an insurance man and realizes that he's acting really too precipitously, he's not fact-checking anything.
Sure, I just don't think a movie is capable of, and certainly this movie isn't capable of teaching the lessons it wants to teach as a movie.
by following out that rage to its logical conclusion.
Too satisfying!
Yeah, but with an audience of people who are just like, what the fuck? This is not going to get us anywhere. Right, so you get both at once.
Yeah, but I'm saying that the satisfaction of the unleashed violence completely overpowers any kind of idealistic rhetoric or critical rhetoric. However, it does allow them to sneak in a lot of... an awful lot of very blatant criticism of the United States.
Yeah, like Luther Adler basically is saying, you know, unless you have global wealth redistribution, we're going to come back. We're going to find a way to do it. You won't be able to stop us.
Sure, and the whole idea is that there's this whole colony in Buenos Aires of European business people and socialite types.
And escaped Nazi officers.
Yeah, who are all working together. And this is the shadowy background of capitalism, basically.
Already by 1945, the narrative of Nazis in Argentina is going strong, and it will continue throughout the 20th century. Many did retreat to that country. You get it in things like even that X-Men movie where Michael Fassbender chases Nazis down there and kills them. As Magneto.
I don't know what's going on with all the Latin American Nazi connections, but Roberto Bolaño certainly likes to...
Well, there's
also homegrown fascism in Latin America.
Well, there certainly is, but Chile and Argentina especially were haven for escaped Nazis.
Yeah, so he's coming by this obsession honestly.
Oh, definitely.
As a Chilean author.
There are some parallels between Cornered and Johnny Angel. The woman posing as Madame Jalnac winds up having just as rough a time with Dick Powell as Signe Hasso had with George Raft.
It's true, but the movie does not strongly signal to us in this case from the beginning that he's wrong.
Well, she's just such an open, pleasant actress.
But in this movie, it seems more like that could conceal...
It could.
...terrible layers, whereas in Johnny Angel, I felt like we had our basic moral compass points.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. But yeah, this movie goes it one better in that sense, because you really are more unsure.
Yeah, I have no idea for most of the movie who to trust.
And Dick Powell has no idea either, but he's protected from that because he doesn't give a fuck. He doesn't care if he gets killed either. I mean, he's stomping around by himself in a foreign country. Well, he doesn't speak the language. He has no passport.
This is the imperviousness I'm talking about, the not caring if you live or die.
Yeah, he's suicidal, clearly. He has no plans beyond getting Jarnac and killing him. And he knows that most of the people he's dealing with are probably going to backstab him. His interactions with Walter Slezak are amazing.
Walter
he's like,
Slezak
You're probably going to backstab me. I don't care.
Walter Slezak is so, so fun.
He really is a great actor.
And the way they play off each other, because Dick Powell is just this heavy, stolid, yet confident, not giving a fuck presence, and Slezak is this weirdly light and effervescent and tricksterish.
Yeah, well, he was a romantic comedy star in his earlier days.
The best exchange is when Slezak starts telling this stone-faced Dick Powell what a shitty job he's doing of being a detective, like a subtle detective. You were probably a very great flyer, and before that had a very promising career as a shoe salesman. And you think he's winning the exchange, and then Dick Powell just cuts him dead with his next remarks.
Yeah, they both have a lot going for them in interpersonal confrontations, but they're coming from completely different directions.
The difference in just the feel, the presence of the two characters, and the interplay between the actors, it's just fantastic.
And this may be the movie that combines the incredibly sinister aspects of Walter Slezak and his more genial qualities the most perfectly, because he has a lot of moments where he's like, yeah, this guy's good company. I hope he doesn't get killed. I want him to stick around in the movie. But it turns out that he's really
awful.
Absolutely vicious. I mean, he's not like the detective, the kind of hapless detective in Born to Kill, but he's also not like Fallen Sparrow. I mean, he's the world authority on torture and the Nazi that is after John Garfield. In that one, he's almost purely sinister, although he gets his little quips in.
Yeah, the fact that he's so likable made me keep wanting there to be some kind of twist to his character.
He's actually gonna help Dick Powell.
Yeah, even long after that's obviously not the case.
No, he doesn't give a fuck either, right? He talks about how he was having a drink with Goebbels at one point. you could sort of decide in your own headcanon that he's just joking about that, and maybe he is. But yeah, he is a servant of all of these more powerful fascist emigres, and he wants to move up in the organization, and he's not above engineering some of their deaths as well. The reason he's sort of egging Dick Powell along is because he's correctly discerned that Dick Powell is just crazy enough to eliminate some of his internal rivals in the fascist gang, and he likes the idea of that. So he is helping him to some extent, but not toward any kind of a goal that we can empathize with. And when we hear the story that goes behind the Madame Jalnac imposture, it's pretty moving as well. I really liked the performance. Micheline Cherel. Yeah, she was really good in this movie, and I don't think I know her from anything else.
She was only active, apparently, until 1947, although she died in 2002.
Oh, looks like she's in Carnival in Flanders, the Fader film. We are going to be doing that for our podcast at some point.
She did some more noirs. I'm assuming So Dark the Night by Joseph H. Lewis is a noir.
She was quite moving in her role when you find out all the terrible things that happened to her and how she wound up in this den of thieves. And how about Diego, the valet? That guy was amazing.
He manages to be, even though he turns out to be one of the good guys, every time he shows up, he manages to seem totally sinister.
Jack LaRue. I'm Diego, the valet. Sometimes I'm a waiter.
Sometimes I'm a waiter, yeah.
That guy I know from The Thin Man. He's one of the lowlifes that William Powell interrogates at a certain point. But yeah, he was wonderful in this role. Kind of unexpectedly great. And really sad when he gets killed by Walter Slezak.
Yeah, it feels really wrong that Walter Slezak ought to be able to kill Diego the Valet. Like, that Diego should not get the upper hand on him.
Well, people underestimate Slezak. I mean, he's willing to do some pretty dastardly things to get what he wants. It's got a really interesting mix of tones because it is insanely grim in so many ways, but then Walter Slezak is really fun. Diego the Valet is really fun. And Morris Karnofsky is really amusing as he tisks the bull in the china shop tactics of Dick Powell and preaches the higher goal of worldwide anti-fascism.
Bosley Crowther absolutely loved this.
Oh, good.
So, do we really think there was any necessity in destroying the careers of these blacklisted filmmakers when Bosley Crowther could watch a film like this and go, satisfying entertainment?
He wasn't troubled by all of the speechifying at the end?
Not troubled.
Well, HUAC was. All right, now, Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, Elise. We saw I Heard It Through the Grapevine.
So this was a movie made in 1982?
Yeah, the start of the Reagan era in America. Not a good one.
Made by Dick Fontaine and Pat Hartley. I have seen, and I mean, this has been restored recently, so I guess that's why we were seeing it.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a little tribute to James Baldwin this month. They're showing a couple of films, you know, on the occasion of his 100th anniversary.
Mm. Well, it has also recently been restored. So I've seen civil rights documentaries before. Obviously, we all have.
Well, we saw Eyes on the Prize together, which is pretty amazing to watch.
But this covered a lot of events I had never heard of before, and it's not a hold you by the hand documentary. Didn't they say there were two prints that were cobbled together for this? Wasn't that part of the introduction?
I think so.
And so there are a few names given, not that they meant anything to me for the most part. There are a few names given, but that at least explains kind of what role the people were playing in the movement. But for the most part, none.
Toward the end, you've got Baraka, Miri Baraka, Leroy Jones, a poet and filmmaker. And you've got Chinua Achebe.
But this was not a hold you by the hand documentary the way When We Were Kings was.
That's true.
At all. Left me with a lot of confusion. Why don't you flesh it out a little bit? Because I'm sure you know more about all of this than I do.
Well, the movie is a look back at the civil rights movement.
Yeah, a very despairing.
Right. From the perspective, you know, of the other side of the supposed triumphs of the 60s, right? And
everyone is talking about how it failed.
Right, and the lessons that they learned that they hope to apply.
Except nobody really thinks any kind of application is going to work. It's very, very early leftist despair.
Well, the hope expressed by the film is that, okay, probably can't win in America, but the world is not America.
Yeah, I mean, that is the conclusion by the end. That is the only hopeful note sounded after a lot of despair and frustration. But obviously that has not materialized. Neither has the socialist criticism from the beginning of the movie, recording how the movement at the behest of Robert Kennedy went off the economic path. Oh, and also, you know, Martin Luther King Jr. probably killed for that reason. Certainly that is a theory.
It's a very prevalent theory that he became a much more dangerous figure on the American scene when he started talking about economic justice.
Solidarity of the poor is raised as a possibility, a political possibility at the beginning of the movie, but the movement went off that course. And of course, that has not materialized, and neither has global solidarity of non-white people.
Not yet. Could happen.
It could all happen.
Yeah. In the grand scheme of things, we have no idea. It's also very funny. James Baldwin is really an engaging presence. They're all talking about some pretty serious, depressing stuff, but he seems to be getting a lot of joy out of interacting with his friends and joking about how they all got fucked over by this, you know, the inadequate rhetoric of the movement.
Well, what he says is, and this is the heart of the despair of the movie, what he says is, our mistake was to think there was a conscience in America to appeal to.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if that was a mistake, or if the mistake was to think that appealing to the conscience of America would be adequate.
Right. When, in fact, material conditions are what matter.
Yeah, and we still haven't figured out a way to fix those. Because, as the movie says at great length, first of all, it's hard enough to get voting rights, but even if you do, there's nothing to vote for. Very familiar to leftists, this kind of talk, criticism of all of our past strategies, but it's interesting to see it happening as early as 1982. I don't know if the ex-civil rights movement was very prescient in that regard, or...
Well, I think it was. By 1982,
Taking one look at Reagan and being like, oh shit.
Right, but even by the late 60s, these kinds of reassessments of the movement were quite prevalent. Black Panthers, you know, they, especially in the late 60s, they really come out of Reagan's California. So a lot of ground laid there. It's not like everyone was on autopilot just trying to get the vote and thinking everything would be great. And then in 1982, they wake up and they realize it was inadequate. It was a long process of grappling with, you know, the possibilities for reform versus radical change, etc.
And then there's also early discussion of tokenism and how it actually strengthens the state.
Yeah.
And I mean, so much what's disturbing is that while you still hear these kinds of conversations on the economic left, they've completely disappeared from liberalism, and including, of course, liberal discussion of race.
Yeah, for the most part, yeah.
For me, the most interesting part of the movie, as a movie, was the way that this drawn-out note of despair is broken up by these musical episodes of gospel music where everyone is singing about their hope. And this hope is just emerging. I mean, it's the same hope that was expressed through music by slaves in their own fashioning, refashioning of Christianity, right? This hope comes out of nowhere, comes out of nothing, a way to keep yourself going. And it's a distant point on the horizon that may never be realized, that you nevertheless have to keep going towards.
A lot of stuff that we saw in the movie, as you say, not the typical ground covered by a documentary on the civil rights era. The scenes driving around Newark with Baraka, those were, I knew vaguely about the riots in Newark, and there were a lot of urban riots in the North in the late 60s, but the footage they had of, you know, soldiers shooting at the tenement buildings,
yeah.
And then flashing forward to these husks of buildings that some people still live in wherever the windows weren't shot out. It was crazy.
Yeah, that's true. Like, some of the instances of brutality by police and military shown in this movie I had never seen before. And I mean, I'm familiar with more well-covered instances, but...
Well, sure, you always see them turning the hoses on the protesters and stuff, but this urban warfare, I mean, that's more like an apartheid documentary, right? With people in townships being penned in by the army and the South African police. That's what this looked like, and that's what that was and partially is. So very visceral imagery there, and very much something to despair over, and it hasn't changed really. So recommend that one, I think. Finally, we'll end on a lighter note, courtesy of our friend Simon and his letter to us. Of course, you're all welcome to write to us at theirbuggy@gmail.com, as Simon has done. Let's hear what he had to say. Subject line, Technoir Colors. The eyes have it. Dear Dave and Elise, My neck is still aching from furiously and enthusiastically nodding in agreement to Elisa's very spontaneous-sounding comments on the treatment of color in Leave Her to Heaven. I've also always thought the Technicolor in this movie, a real favorite of mine, is Jack Cardiff's standard in its aesthetic. Such a powerful way to experience the coldness of Jean Tierney's steely, blue-eyed, yet blank-faced character. Quite extraordinary cinema. So, chapeau to Leon Shamroy. More recognition is clearly due. Unlike you, Elise, I have actually seen a fair bunch of his films without ever having paid attention to the cinematography credit. More shame on me. He seems to have often elevated pretty standard material. I think I now know why I like State Fair, the 1945 remake with Gene Crane, so much. Well, I agree on that score. It's warm to watch without being garish. I think he may have had a thing about blues and purples. Me too, so that's all good.
Well, yeah, definitely.
May I add Niagara, Marilyn Monroe, Desert Fury, Elizabeth Scott, John Hodiak, and Violent Saturday with Victor Mature to any list of tech noir colors?
Oh, of course.
It doesn't always work telling these noir dramas using a warm palette without the rain and shadows, but it's fascinating and jarring all the same. Yeah, I agree. Those are ones that really stand out. It's not just Vincente Minnelli making these kinds of movies in the 50s and Party Girl.
Or Written on the Wind, and of course, Vertigo, we left off.
Pray, did I hear you refer to Black Narcissus as a noir?
Yeah, that popped out.
A non-noir? The more I think about it, I must say I'm not convinced by that, but I love the challenging and original concepts you present.
Well, that was not thought through at all, and Dave didn't challenge it when I said it, or he didn't edit it out either. I suppose I was thinking of a dark psychological drama done in Technicolor in the 1940s.
Well, Kathleen Byron certainly looks like a sweaty noir protagonist at certain points in that film. I'd love to hear or read more on that. Maybe in the future when you screen Black Narcissus.
On the schedule?
Oh, it definitely is. We've got a special subject devoted to the Archers in Technicolor and also one devoted to the Archers in black and white. Hey, it's good for all of us to be challenged, especially when it's a movie we've loved for decades. And listeners may recall that Simon is one of the world's great Helen Pressburger fans, although I am too.
Well, let's just say this. It's a movie that has a feel of the 40s. Black Narcissus.
It's a year in for me realizing that there is sometimes a buggy. I can't imagine the weekend without it.
Neither can we.
No, it's true. That's what we spend a lot of our weekend doing. Also, I can't imagine not ever having been pointed in the direction of Dorothy Arzner. I have you guys to thank for that. That's a massive thanks.
Well, that's interesting because it was just going to that TIFF retrospective that really got us to take notice.
To take notice of her oeuvre, I mean, I always was crazy for Dance Girl Dance and Christopher Strong.
Right.
But there were some others in there that I'd never seen before, and certainly thinking of them all together helped to elevate.
And it also got us interested in Clara Bow.
It did, yeah, The Wild Party. I do implore fellow buggy podders to check out your impressive back catalog. There is a lot to mine there. We've been at it for, you know, 4.5 years now, and yeah, there are quite a lot of episodes back there. If you're ever unsure about whether we've covered something, the website is searchable, but maybe it's not all that user-friendly. If you're ever in doubt as to whether we've covered a film or not, just write to us and I'll let you know. And join our Discord. I'll send you an invite.
We have very delayed replies, but sometimes conversations do get going without us.
They do. A year in, the lights are still dimmed, there's plenty of popcorn left in the box, I'm dead comfy in my flip-up seat, and just ripe to be jabbed by a fresh and challenging idea or two. Thanks, guys.
Well, I'm glad you enjoy it when I impulsively throw something out there that I completely have not thought through at all, and Dave sees fit to leave it into the final edit.
Sure, I like to leave in your challenging thoughts. As Simon correctly points out, whether you agree or not, it can be a spur to thought. And we hope you'll be back for more hopefully thoughtful remarks from your two hosts. For Lily Palmer, part 9 next week, we'll be discussing Main Street to Broadway from 1953, and then a West German film, Feuerwerk, 1954. I'll see you then.